But here's the thing. Did you know that Jesus celebrated Hanukkah? We just finished chapter 23 of Leviticus, and it laid out the Jewish festival calendar with the seven festivals that God gave this new nation of the Israelites. But as we studied each festival, we discovered the wonder of it all, that God meant for these festivals to be more than just a holiday and times of rest and relaxation, but rather that the Jewish calendar prophetically laid out the future. Specifically, we found that the first five festivals, Passover, unleavened bread, first fruit, the Feast of Weeks, and finally the Feast of Pentecost, well, they all take place in the spring. And each predicted the first coming of Jesus, literally and to the day. For example, the Feast of Passover, which fell on the 14th day of their first month on their calendar, which was Nisan. Well, that was the day upon which Jesus, the Lamb of God, the Messiah, was crucified. That Jesus rose from the dead on the 16th day of Nisan, which was the festival of first fruit, which Jesus fulfilled literally and to the day as the first fruit, the first to be resurrected from the dead. Well, each one of these spring festivals was fulfilled in Jesus' first coming, literally into the day, so that we can expect the last three festivals, which take place in the fall, to follow the exact same pattern. That means that the Feast of Trumpets, Atonement, and Tabernacles will be fulfilled literally into the day at the second coming of Jesus in the future. Pretty exciting stuff, especially now that we find ourselves in the middle season, the summer season of history, in which there are no Jewish festivals. We call this time the church age, with the Holy Spirit gathering the people into the church until the full number of Gentiles has come in. This age will end literally and to the day, just like the end of the Jewish summer was celebrated with the sounding of trumpets. Well, this age that we're in, the season of no feasts, the age of the church, this season too will end with a trumpet blast, with the Lord calling the church home. Now, as you look at this chart of the seven biblical festivals, you'll notice one prominent Jewish festival missing, probably the most famous Jewish festival. It's the Jewish holiday taking place right now in December 2021 that coincides with Christmas. It's Adam Sandler's favorite Jewish holiday. It's Hanukkah. You might be surprised to find that Hanukkah isn't found in the listings of the festivals in Leviticus, nor is it found anywhere else in Scripture. Instead, it celebrates an event that took place during the intertestamental period, which is recorded in the non-biblical apocryphal books of 1st and 2nd Maccabees. But here's the thing. Did you know that Jesus celebrated Hanukkah? In fact, the Gospel of John records Jesus celebrating Hanukkah in Jerusalem in John chapter 10. Then came the festival of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Hebrew word for consecration or dedication, it's Hanukkah. Kind of cool to think about Jesus growing up as a child celebrating a festival most of us are familiar with today. And while Hanukkah is not a festival God gave the nation of Israel, it celebrates a historically recorded miraculous event based out of the passage we're studying today in Leviticus chapter 24. A historical event that could only take place if the people were obedient to the commands of God. And as we study chapters 24 and 25 today, we'll discover this important truth. Do not underestimate the importance of obedience to the Lord. So let's dive into Leviticus chapter 24, verse 1. Yahweh said to Moses, "Command the Israelites to bring you clear oil of pressed olives for the light, so that the lamps may be kept burning continually outside the curtain that shields the Ark of the Covenant law in the tent of meeting. Aaron is to tend the lamps before Yahweh from evening till morning, continually. This is to be a lasting ordinance for the generations to come. The lamps on the pure gold lampstand before Yahweh must be tended continually. We learned all about the lampstand in our study through the book of Exodus as Moses received the instructions to build the tabernacle, this earthly model of the actual throne room of God in heaven, which culminates with the Ark of the Covenant, which is an earthly model of the actual throne of God in the Holy of Holies, or most holy place. A four-finger wide curtain separates the Holy of Holies from the holy place, where we find the seven-branch candlestand, providing all the light for the holy place. But we learn that the oil that fills the cups of each candle represents the Holy Spirit, lighting the way to the table of showbread with the bread and wine, representing and looking forward to the body and blood of the coming Messiah, showing the way to the presence of God. Well, this golden lampstand in the tabernacle probably looks familiar because it's a menorah. And the menorah is a symbol of Hanukkah, often known as the Festival of Lights. This holiday celebrating this historically recorded miracle of Hanukkah, well, it took place in the 2nd century BC out of obedience to these four verses here in Leviticus chapter 24. Because God made it clear it was Aaron and the priest's job to keep the seven candles of the golden lampstand burning 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Well, here's the story of Hanukkah. More than 100 years after Alexander the Great, Antiochus Epiphanes rose to power in the region of Israel and began to oppress and persecute the Jews. Well, this evil tyrant prohibited the practice of Judaism and desecrated the temple by requiring the sacrifice of pigs on the altar. Outnumbered and overmatched, a small band of pious Jews led by Judah Maccabee, nicknamed the Hammer, carried out guerrilla warfare against the Syrian army. Well, the Maccabees succeeded in driving the foreigners from their land, and they retook Jerusalem in December of the year 164 BC. The Holy Temple had been left in shambles, being desecrated by the foreigners. And when it came time to relight the seven candles, they found they only had enough oil to light the seven candles of the golden lampstand for one day. The problem being, it was a full week-long process to press the oil properly according to Scripture to produce the oil. Yet in obedience to Leviticus chapter 24, these four verses, they lit the seven lamps and kept them lit all day and all night. Well, miraculously, the one day supply of oil lasted a full 7 days until the new oil could be processed. So every year while Jesus followers celebrate Christmas, Jews celebrate Hanukkah, remembering how the Lord miraculously provides when we are obedient to Him. It's a pretty cool festival. Well, did it really happen this way? Well, who knows? I mean, that's what history says. We have no reason to doubt it, knowing it is in line with how God works even today. But also knowing that the recording of the miracle comes from non-biblical sources. So it's not something we'd ever base a theology out of. However, it is a historical event outside Scripture that reminds us to not underestimate the importance of obedience to the Lord. Verses 5 through 9 provide details on how to prepare and set out bread for the table of showbread, all the way down to verse 10, which records an event that set the tone for the Jewish people on how important it is to obey the Lord when it comes to the use of the Lord's name. Verse 10. Now the son of an Israelite mother and an Egyptian father went out among the Israelites, and a fight broke out in the camp between him and an Israelite. The son of the Israelite woman blasphemed the name. I'd circle that, the name, with a curse. So they brought him to Moses. His mother's name was Shelomith, the daughter of Dibri, the Danite. Remember, as Moses records this book of Leviticus, well, we haven't yet left Mount Sinai. That means tens of thousands of people are camped for months in close proximity to each other. Knowing that there's not much to do besides gathering manna and water that the Lord provides each day, It's likely people's patience with each other was wearing kind of thin. With this many people living in such close proximity, I imagine more than a few fights broke out every day. But this one was a little different. First, the man's mother was an Israelite, but the father was an Egyptian, which meant that he was half Egyptian, half Hebrew, which means his father was part of the many other people, the non-Hebrews that left Egypt in the book of Exodus with the Israelites. This man left with the Israelites, obviously, because he was married to an Israelite. We don't know if this Egyptian man was a follower of Yahweh, but we do know that his son here gets in a fight. And in the heat of the altercation, he's screaming and yelling and cursing, and in the process, blasphemes the name of God. I want you to notice this because it's striking here. Look at the verse. That Moses doesn't write down the name Yahweh, as we've seen him write throughout the book of Leviticus, which we know in our English Bibles every time we see that name translated as the Lord. But he doesn't write Yahweh or the Lord, but instead simply writes the name. It's interesting because in no small part, due to this event right here in Leviticus chapter 24, that the Jewish people, they won't even pronounce the name Yahweh out loud, out of reverence, and to make sure they don't ever misuse his name. In the same way, to make sure they never misuse the name of Yahweh in script, they avoid writing the vowels in the name, only writing the consonants YHVH. Even today, when you read an Orthodox Jewish writer writing in English, they often refuse to write the word God. But you'll see them write G space space. First and foremost, it is because the Jewish people have such a reverence and awe for the name of God. It is too holy and pure a name to pronounce or even write. But secondly, out of fear that they might accidentally blaspheme God's name. Now, we often use the word blaspheme. It's found throughout Scripture, but it's not really a word we understand outside of, we know the Pharisees constantly accused Jesus of blasphemy. Well, simply put, blasphemy means to attack someone, especially God, with your words. To get an idea of the power of what it means, the closest equivalent would be like the modern idea of verbal abuse. But instead of verbally abusing a person, it would be verbally abusing God. And Leviticus doesn't record what this man actually said, but only that in the heat of the fight, he cursed God and spit an attack against God's name with his words. And you can only imagine of the verbal abuse he might use to declare his disgust and hatred towards God and being stuck out here in the middle of nowhere surrounded by all these people. And whether he knew it or not, as he verbally attacked the name of God, he broke a legally binding law from their constitution that they all unanimously agreed to in Exodus chapter 22. Do not blaspheme God or curse the ruler of your people. This was a serious offense, and we're going to see just how serious it is to this man because he underestimated the importance of obedience to the Lord. Verse 12, they put him in custody until the will of Yahweh should be made clear to them. Then Yahweh said to Moses, take the blasphemer outside the camp. All those who heard him are to lay their hands on his head, and the entire assembly is to stone him. Say to the Israelites, anyone who curses their God will be held responsible. Anyone who blasphemes the name of Yahweh is to be put to death. The entire assembly must stone them, whether foreigner, like this man whose dad was a foreigner, or a native born, when they blaspheme the name, they are to be put to death. And we take the Lord's name so cheaply. It's quite common to hear people using and abusing the name of God as a curse word in our culture, or to attack or misuse the name of God for their own benefit and purposes. We take it cheaply, but God sure doesn't. Moses was wise to not simply react, but to put the man in custody in order to have time to ask the Lord for direction on what to do with this man, to seek the Lord on how seriously to take this offense. And God was clear. First, go outside the camp. Second, gather witnesses who heard what he said, and to testify that he is in fact guilty of this offense by laying their hands on his head. Finally, pick up stones and stone the man to death. Capital punishment. Being that this is the first person recorded in Scripture to be guilty of verbally abusing the name of Yahweh, well, God made a big example out of him. And the example, it stuck. This man's mistake directly led to the traditions of the Jews in their careful reverence and respect for how to speak and write the name of God with extreme caution. In fact, when they come to the name Yahweh in Scripture, Orthodox Jews will simply bow their head and say the name. 17. Anyone who takes the life of a human being is to be put to death. Anyone who takes the life of someone's animal must make restitution, life for life. Anyone who injures their neighbor is to be injured in the same manner, fracture for fracture, eye for eye, tooth for tooth. There's that famous phrase we still use to this day, establishing a common law or principle to have a rule of law by in that culture, eye for eye, tooth for tooth. Eye for eye, tooth for tooth has always reminded me of barn rules. If you've ever been to a farm, you may have seen a sign like this. It's the rules of the farm. General principles to behave by to make sure you're free to roam the farm while protecting the facilities and the animals. Rules like, if you unlock it, lock it back up. So there's no question about whether or not to lock a gate after you use it. To that end, if you open it, close it. If you borrow it, return it. All the way down to, if you ride it, feed it. A bunch of simple, easy to understand general principles to live by on the farm. Same thing with eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. General principles that if you wrong someone or hurt them, there is equal justice. The justice fits the crime. The idea being that people will think twice before making a decision or taking an action at the expense of someone else, knowing that the consequence will be you will experience the same offense in return. Notice the context for all this principle, eye for an eye. It's the context of a nation of tens of thousands getting along together in peace. It was a rule to protect society to make sure it doesn't descend into lawlessness. But Jesus actually used this principle of societal law to convey the principle and contrast it to the principles of the kingdom of God. As Jesus' followers, we are not to seek payment, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, in an offense in personal relationships. Instead, Jesus says we are free to give grace. Look what Jesus says in Matthew 5. You have heard that it was said, eye for eye and tooth for tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, which was an insult, turn to them the other cheek also so they can insult that as well. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. The guiding principle for life in the land was to be justice and equal punishment fitting the crime. The guiding principle for the kingdom of God is different. It's love and freely giving grace. Well, back to Leviticus chapter 24. The one who has inflicted the injury must suffer the same injury. Whoever kills an animal must make restitution, but whoever kills a human being is to be put to death. In this guiding principle of eye for eye, the punishment was to fit the crime. An animal's life is not as valuable as a human being's life, because only human beings are made in the image of God. According to this principle, if you take the life of a human being, then justice, equal justice, is you must pay the penalty with your own life. Do not underestimate the importance of obedience to the Lord. Verse 22, you are to have the same law for the foreigner and the native born. I am Yahweh, your God. Then Moses spoke to the Israelites, and they took the blasphemer outside the camp and stoned him. The Israelites did as Yahweh commanded Moses. Such an important verse, even though it's harsh. It demonstrates that they were faithful to what God commanded, that the law of God was not given to Israel for interesting facts or mere guidance, but God expected them to obey it. Well, here, they obeyed God's word even when it was difficult. Do not underestimate the importance of obedience to the Lord. Chapter 25 continues with this idea of obedience, and specifically how obedience relates to faith. Do we really trust the Lord? Because if we trust him, we will obey. Chapter 25, verse 1. Yahweh said to Moses at Mount Sinai, speak to the Israelites and say to them, when you enter the land I am going to give you, the land itself must observe a Sabbath to Yahweh. For 6 years, sow your fields, and for 6 years, prune your vineyards and gather their crops. But in the seventh year, the land is to have a year of Sabbath rest, a Sabbath to Yahweh. Do not sow your fields or prune your vineyards. Do not reap what grows of itself or harvest the grapes of your untended vines. The land is to have a year of rest. Now, throughout Exodus and Leviticus, we've learned again and again about a Sabbath's rest. In its most basic sense, Saturday is the Sabbath. On every day, the Jews were to work hard, but on Saturday, they were to rest from the work as a holy day, set apart to the Lord. To set apart that day was an act of faith, trusting that in the promises of God, that even if they took a day of rest, God would still meet their needs. Well, up until now, this is only applied to them working and resting as a people on a weekly basis. But here, God takes that same principle and applies it to the land, to the soil itself. For 6 years, they are to work hard, plant and harvest the crops from the land. But in the seventh year, they are to take a year off from agricultural work to rest the land. And as an act of faith that the Lord will provide what they need in that seventh year, just like they do on a weekly basis while observing the Sabbath. This would obviously take an act of obedience based upon faith, but remember, there's a practical reason for this. Remember, God created the earth and designed it so that people would receive nutrients that we need to survive from eating crops that are grown in soil. But as soil is overused, it loses its nutrients and begins to produce crops that are not as healthy. The land needs rest. And resting the land every 7 years would guarantee the soil would replenish itself and replenish the nutrients it needs to grow healthy food. Well, I find it interesting how documentaries today, they showcase how the food we produce today is not very healthy because fields are being overused, producing 3 or 4 crops a year, how we don't get the nutrients that we need from these crops outside of all the chemicals and fertilizers they use to drum up some form of nutrition. But the fact is, even our vegetables are lacking. If we'd only follow God's word with our own agriculture, imagine what could happen. But to obey this would take faith that God would still provide even if we take the seventh year off. But the sad reality is that even the Israelites, once they entered the land, they didn't rest in God's promises. They didn't obey this command ever. They got to the land and they planted their crops each year. They got to the seventh year in the land, and they kept on planting and harvesting, failing to give the land a Sabbath's rest. And as a result, when they'd been living in the land for 490 years without giving the land a rest, God said, okay, you won't give the land a rest, so I will. And since God invented math, he's pretty good at it. And so he figured they'd been in the land 490 years, which meant that they had failed to give the land a Sabbath rest 70 times. So So he took the land from them and allowed Nebuchadnezzar's army to come in and take them from the land into exile in Babylon. So the land could rest for 70 years. The punishment fit the crime. And it wasn't until the land had rested for a full 70 years that the Lord allowed the Israelites to return and grow food again on the land. Do not underestimate the importance of obedience to the Lord. Verse 8, count off 7 Sabbath years, 7 times 7 years, so that the 7 Sabbath years amount to a period of 49 years. Then have the trumpet sounded everywhere on the 10th day of the 7th month, on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. Sound the trumpet throughout your land. Consecrate the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout the land to all of its inhabitants. It shall be a jubilee for you. Each of you is to return to your family property and to your own clan. The 50th year shall be a jubilee for you. Do not sow and do not reap what grows of itself or harvest the unintended vines. For it is a jubilee and it is to be holy for you. Eat only what is taken directly from the fields. In this year of jubilee, everyone is to return to their own property. The year of Jubilee was pretty special. So special, in fact, that most Israelites would only experience it once in their lifetime, every 50 years. The idea is that in that year, everything was forgiven. Slaves were set free, and everything was reset back to the beginning as it was when the Israelites first entered the Promised Land. It was a time of grace, forgiveness, and restoration with a 2-year double Sabbath rest of celebration and joy. Everything reset back to original ownership. Because when the Israelites entered the Promised Land under Joshua, each tribe was assigned territory. And then each family within each tribe was assigned a plot of land to cultivate and grow food. Well, that was their family's possession, their inheritance. It was their family's land. The family could never really sell that land, but in a sense could only sell the rights to lease the land for the time period no longer than 49 years, because in the 50th year, all the land was reset back to the original family who owned it. Now, this wasn't their houses or buildings and cities, but only the agricultural land given to them by the Lord as an inheritance. So every land deal and business deal made in Israel was made through the lens and under the context of knowing how close they were to the 50th year when everything was reset back to the original owner. So if that was only a few years away, they'd see the deal like a short-term lease. But if it was 45 years away, the deal would be adjusted to a long-term lease. But as a society, in order for this to work the way God intended, they had to obey God's system. They could not underestimate the importance of obedience to the Lord. Verse 18, follow my decrees and be careful to obey my laws, and you will live safely in the land. And we read down through verse 22, and it talks about the promise of God to produce a bumper crop in that 6th year, so that they'd have enough and it'd be provided for to get them through each Sabbath year on the 7th year. The implication being that God was still faithful to give them a bumper crop every 6th year. But instead of using that provision to rest in the land on the 7th year, they misused that bumper crop to increase their own personal wealth rather than seeing it as the provision of the Lord to rest on the 7th year. Again, they completely underestimated the importance of obedience to the Lord. Verse 23 down through verse 28, the land must not be sold permanently because the land is mine, and you reside in my land as foreigners and strangers. Throughout the land that you hold as a possession, you must provide for the redemption of the land. If one of your fellow Israelites becomes poor and sells some of their property, the nearest relative is to come and redeem what they have sold, which there's that concept of a kinsman redeemer that we'll talk about when we get to my favorite book in the Bible, the book of Ruth, when Boaz becomes the nearest relative, the kinsman redeemer, which includes the property and the widow of Ruth's husband, who dies, a story of romance and sovereignty of God and wonder only made possible through obedience to God's law. 35 through 38 deals with how to lend money to the poor, which is summarized in verse 36. Do not take interest or any profit from them, the poor, but fear your God, so that they may continue to live among you. What a great system of offering interest-free loans to the poor, which is so upside down from how our financial system works, with loans and credit cards charging exorbitant interest, sometimes upwards of 20% to people who are poor and they can never seem to break out of the debt cycle. Well, verse 39, if any of your fellow Israelites become poor and sell themselves to you, do not make them work as slaves. They are to be treated as hired workers or temporary residents among you. They are to work for you until the year of Jubilee. And it goes on describing how no one is to live permanently as a servant or slave. If they become so poor, they have to sell themselves into servanthood. Instead, that 50th year, that year of Jubilee, the servants, the slaves, they are to be set free. Why? Because the Israelites are my servant, whom I brought out of Egypt. They must not be sold as slaves. Do not rule over them ruthlessly, but fear your God. God tells them to never forget they are a nation of freed slaves. Thus, in the year of Jubilee, every slave, every servant is set free. So do not underestimate the importance of obedience to the Lord. Verse 47 on deals with the process to redeem an Israelite. If they've become so poor, they have to sell themselves to a foreigner, ending with verse 54. Even if someone is not redeemed in any of these ways, they and their children are to be released in the year of Jubilee. For the Israelites belong to me as servants. They are my servants, whom I brought out of Egypt. I am Yahweh your God. Again, every 50 years, that year of Jubilee, a very practical reminder, not only that they are a nation of former slaves in Egypt, but also that God brought them into the land of their inheritance, only by the hand of God. So in this land, do not underestimate the importance of obedience to the Lord. Next week, we move on to chapter 26, which is one of the most important chapters in the book of Leviticus, because we've covered a ton in this book. Rituals, priests, sacrifices, festivals, and plenty of commandments. But next week, we get to the answer of why. Why is all this worth it? Why should we not underestimate the importance of obedience to God? What's the benefit? What is it all for? Because next time we'll see the promises of God written out, the absolute blessings in store for those who obey the Lord, and then the curses if they disobey, which will only drive home the challenge to not underestimate the importance of obeying the Lord.